Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Johns Hopkins virologist Andy Pekosz about a topic that should be on everyone's minds, the new bivalent COVID booster shot. They discuss who should get boosted and when, and why some of the guidance may seem confusing. Let's listen. Andy Pekosz, thanks so much for joining me.
My pleasure as always.
So today, Andy, we want to talk about bivalent boosters. And I'm going to start with the easiest question of them all, at least an easy question for you. What is a bivalent booster?
A bivalent booster is the most recent version of the COVID-19 vaccine that is a dose that's been split in half, with half of it being the original vaccine strain and half of it being a strain derived from the BA.5 Omicron variant, which is the variant that's currently dominating here in the U.S. So the idea here is, let's try to start getting immunity to people, not only to the vaccine strain, but also to the currently circulating viruses, so that we can maximize protection against severe disease as well as potentially from infection.
So who should be getting one and when?
So the who is the easy question. It's approved. The booster is approved for individuals over the age of 12, Pfizer for some age groups, Moderna for other age groups. So you'll have to pay attention to which age group you're in. The recommendations for when to get the booster are a little bit more unclear right now. The CDC has put out their overall plan for individuals who are not vaccinated, how they should go through their schedule. And that's two doses of the original mRNA vaccine spaced 3 to 4 weeks apart. And then 2 to 3 months later, a dose of this booster bivalent vaccine. But for most of us, we're way past that area. We've also had infections and other things that have boosted our immune responses. And the guidance for those situations is really not that clear yet on the CDC's website. So we're really relying on scientists to make some recommendations for that.
Well, here I have a scientist right here. So I guess we'll start with after infection. I was infected August 2nd. And I guess I'm wondering, when do I need my booster shot?
Yeah, infection following vaccination is a way to really boost your immune responses. And you can see protection in people from anywhere from 4 to 6 months in that scenario. So there's a lot of immunologists that will say you probably don't want to boost while you're protected. And so if you wait 4 to 6 months after your infection, if you are a vaccinated person, that's probably the time that a booster would give you the best effect in terms of not only strengthening your current immunity, but also giving you that long-term immunity that will last for hopefully a year, 2 years, or maybe even longer.
Mm-hmm. So this is going to be the one that's going to protect me for the longest time?
As long as we don't have another odd variant emerges from out of left field, which again, we can never predict. But right now, everything looks fairly good in terms of Omicron variants are circulating, but this Omicron that's in the bivalent vaccine seems to be well matched to the majority of viruses that are circulating right now.
So my parents have had all the vaccines, right? Although they've had two shots, then they had two booster shots. They should probably be getting this vaccine, this booster shot right now, yes?
Yes, because the bivalent booster will give you a better response to the currently circulating SARS-CoV-2s than the vaccine strain will. The vaccine strain booster will still work. It's still working in terms of limiting severe disease, but the booster will give you that added immunity. And again, you want to think about if you've had the full scale of boosters on top of the initial vaccination, I think you're also able to spread that out and wait about 4 to 6 months after that last booster to get this bivalent booster. Because again, we're now shifting from the pandemic strategy, which was let's get immunity as fast as possible to as many people as possible. We're now shifting to the strategy of let's get long-term immunity in people so we hopefully can avoid having boosters every few months to try to maintain protection in the population.
And then kids, I mean, that's a big question. So I have a teenager and she has not been infected, but she's had her original vaccine and then a booster, and it's been a while. So it's time for her to get her booster as well, I imagine.
Yeah. And again, in that situation where you've had your initial vaccinations, you've had at least one booster, if you wait 4 to 6 months after that last booster, that's a really good time to get the bivalent booster because that will increase your long-term memory as well as give you better protection against the circulating viruses. Two doses of the initial two doses of vaccine and a booster will protect most individuals from severe disease. So you want to then take some time before you get the booster to try to get that long-term immunity going.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Interesting that my family is an example of all of the questions that we have about who gets a shot and when.
And this is the problem that's out there right now. You know, at the beginning of the pandemic, it was really straightforward. You either were infected or you weren't, and then you got the vaccine. Now we have combinations of vaccination, infection, switch it around. Maybe some people got infected and then vaccinated. Maybe some people got infected before the booster and then got a booster afterwards, right? All of these different combinations is going to give a slightly different immune response. And so it's getting more and more difficult to make simple, straightforward statements about what's best for people because there's so much difference in their immune responses based on their exposure history.
I wanted to ask you, we have this question. We got questions from our listeners. Can you get the flu shot and the new booster at the same time?
Absolutely. CDC says there's nothing wrong with getting both at the same time. I think it's probably one of those situations too, where if you're going in to get one, it's probably good to get the other because we know from past experience that if you go in to get one vaccine, say, well, I'll get the next one in a week or two. A lot of people never come back to get that booster because they just get preoccupied with other things and don't go back. So if you have the opportunity to take both, I would say go ahead and get both at the same time. Both will be aiming to do the same thing, protect from infection, protect from severe disease. And, you know, many of the same populations that are vulnerable to severe COVID are the same populations that are vulnerable to severe influenza. So you really need to think about both of those vaccines as accomplishing the same goal, which is protecting people from severe disease, whether it be flu or COVID.
If you're someone who is very religious about getting their vaccinations, is there any advantage to spreading them out?
Not really. The people who have been studied who have gotten both together don't report any different side effects, any different adverse effects. So it doesn't seem like there's an advantage there in terms of putting space between them. A lot of people talk about trying to time the flu vaccine a little bit better. And, you know, October is a great time to get the flu vaccine. I always say that you shouldn't time your vaccines in the same way you shouldn't time your stock market investments, right? Because, you know, invariably, you're probably not going to be right when you make these guesses. So whenever is most convenient, October is a great time to do that. If you do feel the need to split up your vaccines, get your COVID booster first, because there's a lot more COVID around right now than flu, and then go back and get your flu, you know, October, beginning of November, something like that. But there really isn't any reason why you shouldn't get both at the same time, because they're both going to protect and against the same big picture disease.
So you brought up side effects. Are we seeing any changes in the side effects from the bivalent booster?
No, everything's the same as has been reported with the original bivalent booster. It's important to note that the dose of this bivalent booster is exactly the same as the dose of the previous booster. It's just that they've divided it in half and split it between these two different forms of the spike protein that's in the vaccine. So all of the reporting of side effects is essentially the same as with the boosters. Perhaps a little bit less people are reporting side effects, but when you have side effects, it's essentially the same thing that you had when you had your first booster.
Right. So what do we know about how well this bivalent vaccine actually works?
Yes, this is a really important point. The FDA saw data from both Moderna and Pfizer back in June that showed that a bivalent vaccine induced better responses against Omicron than another dose of the original booster vaccine that only had the original vaccine strain in it. Up until then, they had tried bivalent vaccines with other variants, but they never performed better than a single than the booster with just the original vaccine strain. So up until June, there was really no data saying a bivalent booster would work better. The bivalent booster data showed that it was better in June, but the FDA went one step ahead and said, well, the data we saw was with another Omicron variant, BA1, but we know that BA5 is now dominating and should be dominating going forward. So they told the vaccine manufacturers to update that BA1 to the BA5. And again, in hindsight, that now looked like a really great move because that is the virus that's around right now. And so we really are maximizing the match between the circulating viruses and the vaccine strains. Now, what that means, though, is that we don't have long-term studies in terms of how efficacious it is with this specific BA.5. Mm-hmm. We can infer from all the other studies that it'll be good, but that's the data that we're trying to collect in the scientific community through a number of studies that are going on right now. But I want to emphasize that, you know, the history of mRNA vaccines and their safety is unquestionable. And again, people have looked at bivalent formulations and they haven't been beneficial until Omicron. And so this is really a move by the FDA and public health officials to try to get at least even with the virus instead of constantly being 2, 3, 6 months behind what the virus is doing.
Terrific. We have some listener questions I wanted to throw in here. It says, okay, the first one, and maybe this really speaks to what you were just talking about. Why is it taking so long to deliver an Omicron-specific variation of the vaccine? I thought these new mRNA vaccines could be developed quickly. I guess it's a matter of perspective, right?
Yeah, and they were developed quickly, but clinical trials were what was done with the first one. So the clinical trials that were reported to the FDA in June were actually initiated back in February and March, and that was about a month or two after Omicron emerged. So in fact, the Omicron vaccines were put into place very, very quickly. They just did the clinical trial to look at how effective they were, which is why it's now rolling out. And again, the change in June to update to the BA5 caused them to really go back to the drawing board and make new vaccines. But think about it. June, 3 months later, we've got vaccine to give to people. That's a really amazing task. And it's not like we have a couple hundred doses of vaccine, right? We have hundreds of thousands, soon to be millions of doses of vaccines within 3 months. So it's really an amazing scientific advancement to be able to do that at that scale and in that time frame.
Let me, I think I've got time for one more, maybe two more questions from listeners. This one says, I had COVID in early June, fully recovered and got sick again in late July. Since we know that Omicron subvariants commonly evade immunity, how should we reconcile this with the bivalent booster, which is supposed to provide stronger immunity against Omicron? Is vaccine-induced immunity better than immunity from infection?
Vaccine-induced immunity is better because it's safer. And it's really designed to only induce that kind of protection that is going to protect you from disease, right? When you get infected, you have all of these other symptoms that is the virus sort of wreaking havoc in your system. So the bivalent booster particularly on top of an infection, is going to really strengthen your immune responses to very, very high levels and do so in a very safe way. So the bivalent booster is going to be important for infected individuals to take. The spacing will be the thing to think about. And again, that 4 to 6 month window is really what you need to think about if you've been infected before you consider the booster. But definitely consider the booster because it'll strengthen responses and help them turn into those long-term responses.
Are you concerned that we are creating some confusion here and that it's going to make it harder for us to get people vaccinated with this new booster?
Yeah, communication on this issue has really got to be very, very clear and careful. Much of the guidance is being left to sort of people to decide and medical providers to decide. And that is going to breed a little bit of different responses from different people. And that then breeds confusion and hesitancy. And so I'm really hopeful that over the next couple of weeks, we're going to get a real crystal clear guidance from the CDC about how to deal with boosters in these other contexts we've just described, infection, fully boosted people, how much time to put between these. All this stuff is going to have to get done relatively soon. And again, some of it's going to take some time because we have to do the studies to really get the data to make those firm recommendations.
This has really been enlightening. So thank you so much for joining me, Andy Pekosz.
Thanks very much.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.